I'm going to speak about grammar and how about avoiding some of the time it takes to learn it. We all probably are scared of language with a lot of tables. Now, take a little look at the statistics. You have to learn at least 1,000 words to just manage a language, barely. If you look at even the worst tables you have seen in your grammar, look at only the regular ones. Maybe if you are really unlucky, there will be about 500 of those. So the task of learning a grammar of even the worst languages should, from that point of view, be smaller than learning even the most elementary vocabulary. One point more. This was about the morphology. The morphology cannot scare you now. Even, well, there are languages like Afrikaans, where you can count it on one hand, what you need to learn of morphology. If you take syntax, you have heard about the order of elements in a sentence, SVO and so on. For normal language, if we say there are about 10 patterns you need to learn, and then you need to embed something, that's a rule about how to put relative clauses and things like that. Let's say add 2, 3, 4 ways to do that. All in all, the whole grammar you have to learn should be below at least 500. If I say 500, then it's a very difficult language. Then we're speaking something like Russian or even Slovenian, which has a dualist. Okay, I'll see. The next thing is, what has this to do with grammar? Let's first take a look at phonetics. There are two ways you normally explain the families of languages. There is a Stammbaum. It says there are rules. If you change a rule, then you get a new branch on a tree. And there's the other one that says that things evolve in waves. Those were made by German grammatician in the 19th century, and something like that is also true for grammar. The other one, that's actually the Lorentz attraction, attractor. That's something regular that comes out of a little regularity in mathematics which you cannot see, but which provokes some regularity in the results you see. And don't mind the grammar here. It's just the idea that there are some very simple rules which can explain most of the grammar in a language. But then we have the evil thing down here. That's a slime mold. That's the thing that makes irregularities in a language. It's something that spreads from a mold somewhere and grows across the whole thing, moving in a pattern that is decided by the rules you have up here. Any language you have found has irregularities in the rules. Normally, we are very scared of the rules. We look at the tables and say, this is a very dangerous language. We should be very scared of the exceptions. But the exceptions are really the rule here. Because if you scratch a little in the surface of a language, you'll find that below the rules, you'll always find words, idioms, expressions, and there are 10,000 of those. So the hard part of learning a language is really not learning the grammar. Be happy that there is something that is regular, because the norm is that it isn't regular. The norm is you have to learn each case, each word, as a word. And that eliminates a lot of your grammar learning, because you should not learn it as grammar, you should learn it as words. We have a language learner here, very young language learner. With a book, the book, you shouldn't mind about the book, it's just on the picture, she is turning it upright down. Well, what can you expect a child like this to learn? Not a table, not a grammatical rule. The only thing you can expect is to teach a child a word, or maybe an expression, and then will that child, extend the scope of that example you have given by finding other examples you could use. If you say fathers, then you know that there's something about things belonging to others, then you put an S on it. Okay, then you try mothers, teachers, and so on. That is fine, and then you get to my and try mice, and you are whacked. No, it's not mice. It's mine. And then you discover that rules have a limited scope. And that's where chaos starts. Because if you take the rule, you should never expect a rule to cover all you need to learn. And the first rule here is expect your rules to follow the Pareto principle. You can make order in maybe 80% of a language. The rest will be a total mess. So we have to extend the scope of our rules from simple examples. This is taken from a guidebook, language guide to Cebuan, a language spoken in the central part of Philippines, of which I bought because I found it interesting. I have not learned that language. I'm not going to. The funny thing is here, contrary to many language guides, this one has some examples that are very close to each other. A more normal language guide will make examples that are so different as possible. And you cannot make rules from things that are totally different. You have to vary one thing at a time. And if you do that, you can maybe get the idea about a rule and see how far it takes you. So this book here is an exception because you see Canos Kunimo, I don't know how to pronounce it. Canos Kunimo, too high it is, and Canos Kunimo. That's two things that are very close. And the one is the answer to the other. There is some element that is common. On that basis, you can start understanding a language. And a child has only that way to learn a language. Child cannot read a grammar, cannot read a textbook. A child actually has to do this analysis on very simple materials to understand and learn a language. So this is a slightly more complicated case of the same thing. This is actually taken from a Hungarian version of the Kautovels books, which exist in German. Asimil has got something that is almost the same. And the special, does it still say something? Okay. The special thing about these books is they use what I call hyperliteral translations, or word-for-word translations, and a normal translation. That means you can take every word and find out what does that word do in this context. And you cannot use a translation that is a free translation to learn from unless you learn the complete expressions. If you learn complete expressions, okay, then how to do as an expression. But in another language, it will be expressed with another syntax and words that doesn't translate exactly. So you cannot extend the scope of an expression you learn unless you can split it into its parts and find out what it really says. And it's hard to read what is written here, so I'm not going into details. But one of the things is, this is Hungarian. I chose Hungarian because it's got a very different syntax, a very different morphology from most of the languages I know, which are German, Germanic or Romance. So if I have to learn how the Magyars are thinking when they speak, then I have to know exactly which words they use, even if their expressions don't correspond to something in language I already know. I have to know exactly what they actually say. Even the sum of the words is another than I would expect. Because that's the way I can extend by making new rules. That's the way I can use one expression to learn another expression. If I just took the whole expression, I would have to learn all expressions in a language. And that's very long words, if you take it like that. It's a lot of words, and there's no clear boundary between the things I have to learn and things which are just made up for one book or something. So you have to go down and look at what the words really say. And I'm not going to into details here, I'll just take one single example. For instance, here is something correct me if I pronounce it totally wrong, something like Jøvung. And it's written here, that means common via. That's the first plural, first person plural. Okay, some languages wouldn't express it with that. They would, like Afrikaans, not have any ending. Others would, like perhaps Indonesia, have the choice between we that includes yourself and the opposite person, and we that only included you but not the other person. And you have to know that thing, otherwise you cannot say you have understood that expression. So a normal grammar will give you some ideas about this, but you have to look at examples, concrete examples, because remembering a room from just a description with some Latin words is almost impossible unless you can tie it down to concrete sentences in the language with a firm knowledge of what that language, what that sentence actually says, and not only what you would say in another situation, in the same situation in another language. Let's go one further. Well, of course, there are people who have tried to systematize this, and this is from a test for linguistic aptitude. And it's a test, as far as I know, which was devised by the American military. It's called MLAT. And it's got four parts, and then they've got a test version on the internet, which is free, with a few questions. And they come up with some nonsense languages, and then you have to guess. You show whether you are a linguistic genius by showing whether you can guess what they mean with a certain word or something, a certain word order or something. Actually, this is a formalization of the process which you are expected to do if you don't have a grammar. The next point will be, of course, you have a grammar. You are not like the little girl there who couldn't read that book. You have the choice of looking in a grammar. And now we go back in time. Now we go back to the bad, black, old school days. This is my first Latin textbook, which I saw somewhere in the late 60s. And I was taught by a teacher who was a firm believer in grammar translation. That's a method which has been totally ridiculed lately because it simply doesn't teach you to speak a language. It teaches a lot of grammar. It teaches you how to translate. It doesn't teach you to speak a language. But the same teacher which I had for Latin also taught German. And I have found since then that I remember my Latin grammar much better than grammar I would have learned using other methods. But you have to do something more. If we go to the first lesson in the first Latin book I ever saw, it doesn't matter what it says, it is difficult to read, but it starts out simply with Italia terra est, Sardinia insula est, and things like that. And then above here, it says exactly which parts of the grammar you have to study to understand the text below. You see, this is actually the foundation of all textbooks. They have tried to make them more appetizing by removing some of the grammar, by adding smaller tasks and things like that. But this is the fundament of every textbook you'll find. Some textbooks have, of course, kept the grammar. Others try to eliminate it. The textbooks which don't give you a translation, this does, but only for the first lessons. There's another Latin textbook in Danish which is only in Latin. All explanations, all cases are explained using Latin. And I think it works, but I cannot see the reason why you should make so much trouble to make your pupils work in a language which they don't know yet. The simple thing is to give them the explanations in a language they understand, and when it then comes to reading, then you can hope They can do it without explanations in your own language. But first, this first lesson refers to these syntactical rules, and this part of the verbum sum. And I think it's nice to see the good old days where things really were explained in detail, and where you could find things divided in a logical way instead of finding them hidden away in strange corners of your textbook. This is simply the forms of I need to use from the verbum sum. And now comes the question: should I learn those by heart? Okay, yes, these I should learn by heart for one simple reason. There are so many different stems involved here that you can just as well accept that each of those is a word in its own right. Learn it as a word with the sentences you can find. And nowadays you can get more sentences than this book would supply. You can find sentences on the internet, or you can have a teacher give them to you. But in a case like this, where there are at least there are at least three different stems involved, there is no reason to try to learn it as a system. There's no system. It's simply six different words. And given it that you have to learn 1,000 words just to make the simple Latin of Livy known to you, then six words is not much. You have to accept that and learn those. But later we have a paradigm where you can actually learn 1,000 words just by learning six forms, and then it pays, because those six forms will cover 1,000 different words. So you also have to, you always have to make that calculation: is it really worth learning this as a system, or should you just find six examples of this and learn those six examples? And in this case, I would definitely go for Agricola sum. I am a farmer. That's easier to remember than sum es est es sumus and so on. Let's see. At the next page, now we come to a harder grammar. I don't speak Polish, I'm trying to learn it. But I took some pages from this one because Polish is one of the languages with as fame for being difficult. And I say fame in this house here because other people might say scary. But I think here in this group of people, it will be seen as something fun if it is difficult. I have taken here one little example. It's the choice in the masculine between a U and an A in the genitive singular of hard stems and willer stems and soft stems. Just the choice between U and A in one form. This is the simple explanation in that book. This is the these are the pages with the details. And then, if I'm a really old-fashioned pupil who does as the teacher says, then I'll start learning that. No, it's impossible. No human being can read those pages and remember that stuff. So, what I did, I wrote down the main categories here. And then I have to go to find some examples. There are in each of these subgroups maybe 5 or 6 or 10 or different substantives that follow a certain rule. And the single rule I can say here is this is total chaos. It's a battle zone. There are two forms which compete, and they have left a borderline which is totally impossible to pinpoint. You can say maybe that you can get a sense of which form you should use. The normal form here would be A. In all other masculine substantives, it would be A. But in this U here, you should find examples with a rare case. And in this case, the exception is those that have a U. So find examples of each of these categories, use one, look them up on the internet, learn those examples of words with a U there, and forget about those with an A, because that's the general rule. I haven't made a page about this, but let's take something which is more relevant for many of you. German gender. Substantives have three genders in German. There's a simple rule, all diminutives are neutrum. Most substantives on a vocal vowel, and that will normally be an E, are feminine. Most of the rest are masculine. So the only group that can be difficult are those that are neutrum and end in a consonant. Learn some of those and don't try to learn the rest, because you have simple rules for two groups and the rest are just the rest. Another case, for instance, in Russian, prepositions have different cases, they govern different cases. The simple rule, learn those that have a dative, learn those that have an instrumental, learn those that have an accusative, assume that the rest have a genitive, and don't try to learn it. Because in most cases, you will save more time by just assuming that it's a genitive than it would take to look it up. And somewhere along the line, you will have learned enough to see the exceptions, if there are any exceptions, where it comes to something that looks like it. The simple idea behind this is, look for the exceptions, learn the exceptions, but not as a system. Learn the exceptions through some examples, because that's easier to remember. And the rest is just something that will follow automatically when you cannot put it in one of those boxes you learned through your examples. This is one of my green sheets. Those who follow HCLL have maybe read about my green sheets. It's when I take some part of the grammar and I write it on a piece of paper at an early stage, and if you find some errors here, I cannot guarantee that this is correct. I made it at an early stage during my learning because it is part of my learning. But I didn't do this to learn that by heart. I put this page on a note stand. And when I read or write, I have it within reach, just as a dictionary or an internet book. The problem with grammar is it is not easy to look things up. So if I take this, it will cover maybe the 80% of Pareto's rule, because the rest, the 20% that are different, that don't, the exception from this, they will take me so long to look up in a grammar that I don't have time to write the thing I'm going to write. So this is my summary of the things I want to know about Polish adjectives and substantives in one sheet. And you could say I could go to Poland if I just knew this and had found the errors that must be there. This is everything you need to know about adjectives, articles, and substantives in Icelandic. And of course, you can cut it here, because this pronouns, this up here, that's the part you need to learn as rules. The rest are exceptions, which you have to learn word by word, and you can just as well accept it. I'm not going to discuss everything in Icelandic. I'll just mention, they have got articles in front of the substantives, just as English. But sometimes they put them at the end as a postfix to a word. They add them, and therefore we've got two red parts here. The articles before a word and those which are attached to the end of it. And it depends on whether there is an adjective or not. Add to that, there are two kinds of substantives. They're strong and they're weak. The strong ones, they have got one set of endings, and the other ones have a similar kind of endings. All that is in those few lines up here. If you know that, you can go to Iceland. And the rest, you cannot learn by learning through a grammar. You have to find examples, because you cannot remember all the exceptions. It's that simple. Just accept that some parts of the grammar are not worth learning as grammar. Some parts of the grammar are words. This, I know it's hard to see, but I didn't know how hard it would be to see. I can see maybe there's a plus sign, and then I can make it bigger. Let's try. Yeah, it comes here. Yeah, this is all you know need to know about Latin adjectives and substantives and almost all the necessary pronouns in one sheet. And then they say, this is the part of the Latin grammar except the verbs you need to learn. The rest are exceptions. And exceptions should not be learned through rules, they should be learned as words through examples. And now I have to get it down, but before we do that, maybe I can move it a little. Yeah. Let's take it here. One thing you can wonder, we have got a lot of endings. Those endings are really something you should learn just as you learn words. This ibos here, which you have got in two cases in the plural, that's just as much a word. It's just attached to something else, but it can be learned as a word. It has something like a meaning with this grammatical system. It means it is a dative or it's the ablative. And if you take this not as something you have to learn within a table, in this case it is part of a table, but learn it simply, if you put ibus on the end of a word, then it's suddenly the plural ablative. Well, and then comes the problem. Lots of these forms have the same endings. There are some in A here. There are many places in this system where you have an A. Then I ask you, how many things do you know about the city of Berlin? You only need to know five or six things about this ending, namely the places it is used in this system. You know hundreds of things about Berlin. Why can you remember that? Because Berlin has become an entity in your mind. It has become something you attach meaning to, you see as a place on the earth, whereas this just is part of the grammar and you don't like grammar. If you say this is a place on the planet, and then in this case the planet is this green sheet, then you can suddenly use it for one thing more. A green sheet like this is a place to put things just as you can put them on a map. And then you suddenly have a graphical system available to you. And there's one difference between rules and graphics. You can access graphics in a flash. In a moment, in a second, you know if you go six down, there's an ibus. Just as if you follow spread, you will find Berlin. And if you learn it as a rule, then you have to learn everything about what an ablative is, what a dative is, and relate that to the endings. There are two ways to explain roots, you know. There are people who just show you a map. This is a map. There are other people who tell you the way on the form. First you go to the green house, and then you turn right, then you turn left, and then you turn left again, and 500 meters away, there's a gas station. You cannot see it, but just before that, the museum or whatever it is. It's easier to show your map. For some people, this will be a way to remember singular forms even before they've learned the whole system. They can remember ibus is here, and there's a big flat plane there. You don't know what is there. You learn that later, but now you know where ibus is. And for some who have to learn, for instance, Russian, this might be an idea. Learn some of the forms and forget about the rest until you have learned those which are easy. The simple rule is to pick always the low-hanging fruits first and leave the rest until you are smarter. And now I have to continue. Now we get to another. I mentioned prepositions before, and this is prepositions. I have made one single thing. This is Polish, by the way. This is taken from the Pont's small grammar to Kurz und Bündig or so was. To prepositions of Polish, And I have simply said, these are genitives. Which preposition with genitive are used for something else? Only two? Learn those. The rest, you have to learn them, of course, but exams and everything. But those two are special because they are used for something else. Over here, instrumental. Again, two are different because they are used for something different. One is from the genitive, and the other one is not used for any other purpose, with other case. Down here, locative one case is an exception. Learn that. And accusative, forget that. Every single preposition, with one exception, has also an use with another preposition, with another case. If you have learned already those with instrumental and locative, you don't need to learn those with accusative. Because everything here, with one exception here, and this is prisit or something like that. Polish people can explain how that's pronounced. I'm not at that stage yet. One exception, the rest of the accusative propositions can you forget about. You need to know them, but you don't need to remember they govern the accusative because it's a simple matter of learning the other case they are used with. Now I'm going to go through a couple of things I did to motivate myself. The best way to motivate yourself to look in a grammar is to find yourself in a total mess. This is simply, I found out I had to remember the things you just saw a moment ago, and what did I do? I looked for examples. I simply took a text and wrote down every case of the genitive in adjective and substantive, and I got to this and thought, now I have the mess that would motivate me to find the system. And then I was motivated to go back and read the grammar. That's not learning grammar, that's learning psychology. And this is what I wrote about. I made my own green sheet, and I'll of course change it later when I become more versed in Polish, but this was what I knew about them at that time. I have very few things left to say. I mentioned that making things graphical can make them easier to remember. These are known as Sandfeld Cirkler, the circles of Sandfeld in Denmark. Because it's a simple rule for French, says whether it's le lui or la leur, or it's le. What's this? It cannot be le. It cannot be le. There's something wrong here. No. Okay. Me lui. Yes. Okay. I just got confused for a moment. But it's a way to remember which order they come in a French sentence. And of course, you can make your own system. Sandfeld is just one which was used by Danish grammarians and put in a form where small children in the school could learn it. The next one I'll show. This was a simple example with Sandfeld. Now we come to syntax. And I'm not going, it's late and we have a little time. I'm not going to speak about Chomsky now. I'm not going to even mention transformation grammar. But we have to learn a little about how to imagine sentences in order to get the structure of sentences. And I've simply taken something known as a sentence knot. And this sentence knot is characterized by three layers. We have a thing, and we have a relative pronoun that points up to the thing here. And this relative pronoun is in a sentence that is the object of another verb. This structure would be very difficult to explain in words, but it is very easy to see the system once you have made a drawing of it. So I say, instead of making a lot of complicated explanations in word about sentence structures, it pays to put them up as small boxes with sticks and pin, and maybe you could even add some signs for what the subject is and things like that. But make things graphical, because you can access a graph, drawing like this easier than a long explanation. And then this is my last page. This is what I have summarized my learnings about grammar, how I have summarized my learnings about grammar. And I'm not, I don't think, can you read that? Or should I go through them once by one? I think I'll do it quickly, but we have to leave some time for questions, if there are questions. The first is, forget about content when you study grammar. When you read a book, and you are very interested in knowing how it went with a pair who were in love and moved to Berlin or whatever and got shot and I don't know what, then you cannot concentrate on finding the subject and verb and finding out about the different grammatical forms. You have to concentrate on the things which is important, and that is the grammar, if that's your goal. And then you can read about the sentimental side of the story later. The next thing, stick to comprehensible grammar and postpone intractable details. If you cannot understand anything in an explanation, then it may not be your fault. And anyway, it would be more smart to learn some more of the language instead of just wasting your time banging your head against something you don't understand yet. Next, look for general principles, but accept mere rules of thumb. Most grammar has a limit where it breaks down. Don't expect to explain every case of a substantives and things like that. We just saw an example with A and U in the Polish grammar, where I say don't expect to find a simple rule there. Forget about it, learn a lot of examples, and you'll at some point know by the feeling of it which one to use. Visualize rules where it is possible. I've just illustrated that. Learn exceptions as isolated words. And now as an isolated word, I would have preferred another formulation. Isolated words is wrong. Learn them in examples where you can see the functions of those words. But learn them as short and memorable phrases and not long quotations by famous authors. Learn rules through simplified examples. Okay, I've got it there. See all the grammatical elements as essentially meaningful. Some teachers will tell you an ending is not meaningful, only the whole form is meaningful. That's nonsense. We just saw ibus is meaningful. It says it's this place in the system. That's a meaning just as well as says a cow has four legs and a tail. A meaning can also be a reference to language. Write the things you want to remember down, because 5 seconds later you have forgotten it if you haven't written it down. And if you write it down, you can look at it the next day and repeat just as you do with words if you use that method. Accept that other languages don't follow the rules of your language. That's well, I think nobody would oppose to that, but I think many people forget it when they learn languages. They accept maybe that English has very few cases, but then they should say, it's not a problem that there are three numbers, for instance, in Slovenian. That's just the way it is. And therefore, the last one is stop whining. Stop whining. Don't stop crying. And that's the last one. Is there any question now? I don't know whether we should get the other microphone activated. Other, are there any questions first? Very few. People are totally dumbstruck. Will? Still no questions? Well, then I'll put this out and we are free 10 minutes before time.